Okay, let's move on to the topic for corruption. That there's a famous saying in the world, in English world, power corrupts, absolute power corrupts absolutely.
Yes, Lord Acton. And
yeah, so, you know, what we see is the U.S., the American democratic system dividing the power, whatever the system is trying to curb, you know, the corruption, the human abuse of the power. I remember you told me a story, a senator from New Mexico, Domenici, that once he received a pair of boots and his property to over $200, and the U.S. Congress has a rule each year could only receive $100 for the gift. Now, what we see, the American government still have all kinds of ways to abuse the power, you know, to have the corruption. Do you believe that the American system still can improve, can curb the power and corruptions? What do you see?
Correct. Well, that's actually embedded inside the Declaration of Independence, okay? Because it says that if the government no longer supports the right to life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness, okay, that it is not only our liberty to take that government down and establish a new government that will secure the right to life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness. It's not only our right, it's our duty. It's our duty. Mm-hmm. So if there is any government that becomes corrupt beyond repair, and the founders are very careful. The founders were very, very patient. In fact, before the Declaration of Independence was written, that there were many attempts by the colonists to talk to the British king, to talk to the British Parliament, to say that what you're doing in the States is humanly not accurate, is not right, but also that we are Englishmen and that we are entitled to the full rights of all Englishmen. And so the crown and the parliament, they were treating the people in the colonies as a second class citizen. And the second and the colonists said, time out. We are British subjects. We are English, and we are entitled to English rights. And you're denying those English rights. Please reinstate those, because if you don't reinstate them, we are going to claim our independence. And so this went on for many, many years, and the king just kept closing his ears, paid no attention to it. Edmund Burke, who you're familiar with the quote that says, all that it takes for evil to prevail is for good men to do nothing. See, that quote comes from Edmund Burke. Edmund Burke fought on the floor of the House of Parliament, and he fought the king and he fought other members of Congress. And he said, what you're doing to America is wrong. You have got to stop this. So there were people inside the British government, but in the end, the government and the king did not change their attitude. They refused to protect the rights of the colonists as Englishmen. And after a long train of abuses, as written in the Declaration of Independence.
So look at today's American politics. We see the media, American leaders, or, you know, some of the institutions, even, you know, DOJ, whatever. We see so many scandals. So do you see today, let's say as the election 2020, people are doing their right, doing their liberties to, you know, replacing or change, or do you see that?
Yes, there are many people that want to see quote unquote progressives. That's just the American word for communist. Okay, because I don't care what the label says. I look inside the jar, mm-hmm. you know, inside the jar that has communism on the label is a certain set of principles as to how the human being is treated and how the government is abusive. And inside the progressive jar is identically the same thing. And in fact, some of the historians and biographers for Karl Marx and Mao Zedong, and I've read multiple biographies. I read the Red Book. I have it in the next room, that in reading the principles, there is no difference in principle between what Black Lives Matter or Antifa or progressive Democrat. They are saying the same thing. They are doing the same thing that Mao, Stalin, Hitler, and others did in previous generations. And the reason is not that they're Stalinist or Maoist or, you know, Nazis. The reason is the worldview, the foundational faith system of the Progressive Party basically says God doesn't exist. The government, we the government, not we the people, we the government, we're in charge and have final authority in the life of every human being. And so if that is the worldview, then really under that worldview, there can't be corruption, because all morals then become relative, and whoever has the biggest gun or the most political power, that whatever they say, it's not corrupt, you see? It's what it is it's just in line with their worldview. It reminds me of Orwell's book, Animal Farm, where once the pigs take over the farm, they say, you know, four legs good, two legs bad. And after they move into the mansion, then they're smoking the cigars and drinking the whiskey. And then they say, oh no, hey, you know, two legs good, four legs bad. If there's not something eternal like God that is the basis for truth, you can't have justice. Mm-hmm. And you also can't have corruption, mm-hmm. because it just is. It just is. But if there is, but if the biblical worldview is true and justice is grounded in God, then we know what is corrupt and what is not corrupt. So I find it very interesting, the people that say that truth is relative, but right after they say that, they want to accuse you of being corrupt. Well, if truth is relative, how can you be corrupt or not corrupt? You know, there is no truth. And that's why it's important that we keep coming back to biblical worldview. Let me give you an example. Very good friend of mine, Congressman Randy Cunningham, Duke Cunningham from California. There was a movie that Tom Cruise played called Top Gun, and many of your viewers might have seen the movie Top Gun. And if you remember that there was the Russian MiG, you know, jet was coming, and then the American, you know, flew upside down over over the jet or the Russian, and he looked down, you know, into the Russian cockpit and flew up. That's a true story. My friend Randy Cunningham, he was that pilot.
Oh, really?
He was a hero. He was a hero. And somewhere along the line, he began to take bribes. And he began to take presents. That his moral compass got twisted. He's still my friend. He's a sinner made in the image and likeness of God, just like I'm a sinner made in the image and likeness of God. But he did something that was illegal. It was against the rules of the House of Representatives. It was immoral. It was corrupt. But you see, if there's no such thing as truth, you can't make rules, or there can't be a morality. But what happened was that the Duke finally, he went to prison in Arizona, okay? Mm-hmm. And he should pay the price. If I do that, I should pay the price. And Jane, you're my friend and I love you. If you do that, you should pay the price. Mm-hmm. But you see, what happens is that a biblical worldview provides the basis to have an ultimate a scale of what's right and wrong, a measurement. If you don't have an eternal measurement of what's right and wrong, anything goes. Anything goes. There can't be corruption. So what we're seeing in Washington among some people, and there are Republicans who have been corrupt. I have another friend, Jesse Jackson Jr. His father is very famous. His father is the Reverend Jesse Jackson, who worked with Martin Luther King from Chicago, Operation Push. Hmm. And he was a friend of mine, and he was using the money that was given to him to run for his office. He took that money and used it for his own personal purchases. Unethical, illegal, against the federal election code. Jesse Jackson went to prison. Jesse Jackson broke the law. He went to prison. He was a Democrat. Mm-hmm. Duke Cunningham broke the law. He went to prison. He's a Republican. You see, that's how justice works. Justice is blind. It doesn't matter whether you're a Democrat. It doesn't matter what your skin color is. Jesse Jackson was black. Duke Cunningham was white. They stood before the law. They were judged by the law, and they paid the penalty under the law. That's what it means, justice for all. It's not justice for if, you know, you want to go burn down a stat, you want to go burn down a federal building, take down a statue, shoot somebody in public that because of, you know, somebody's race or political party that you're not held accountable. That's not justice under the law. And so corruption, it doesn't matter whether it's in China or the U.S. Mm-hmm. I'm just telling you, people in America and people in China, both of us, regardless of race, we are sinners made in the image and likeness of God, but we are sinners in need of God's grace, and we need to be thinking about that sin, have a change of mind where we think and turn back to God, a change of heart where we decide and turn back to God, and then live that out in our actions.
So how do you see election this year, 2020, in about just over, you know, less than 2 weeks?
From
Christian perspective.
Well, we addressed this a little bit earlier, and that is this election is the election that should be least about personality, but more about principles.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? There's two candidates.
Right.
Both sinners, both flawed. One candidate is carrying a message that the ultimate authority in the life of the citizen is the government. And that's Joe Biden. And even his own Catholic priests are saying so. And then you have Donald Trump. And Donald Trump, he is flawed. He's a sinner. I personally don't care for how sometimes he speaks carelessly, okay? But when I look at his deeds, he has done more to save the lives of unborn children. He has done more to lift Blacks and Hispanics and other minorities out of poverty by creating a space in the economic system of America to rise up out of poverty, to have the dignity of working hard and bringing home a paycheck and paying, you know, your own bills without being dependent on the government. That the list goes on and on and on of the good and decent things that that Donald Trump has done since elected. And I'll confess to everybody that's watching this on YouTube, and that is the last time that I voted, I did not vote for, I cast my ballot for Donald Trump, but I did not vote for Donald Trump. Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. I voted and basically vote, it comes to the word voice, Latin word voca, vote. I was giving my voice against Hillary Clinton, not because she was Democrat, but because she used the term healthcare to describe a system that would systematically end the lives of senior citizens. I raised my voice against that. That was part of what was going on in the healthcare plan. They called that there was policies in there to tell senior citizens when to die, and they called that healthcare. Okay. And that is the corruption of language that precedes the fall of a civilization and the fall of a country. So I voted against Hillary, and I cast my vote for Donald Trump. This year, I am going to be voting for Donald Trump. I early voted down at my county clerk, and I encourage everybody to vote early in person. And, you know, wear your mask, do what you have to do in your locality, but to secure your ballot, you should go and vote in person. There's too much fraud going on at the polls right now. And we can talk about that in just a second, but I cast my vote for Donald Trump because he has done more for the minorities of the country. He has done more for the unborn. And though he is flawed like King David when he committed adultery against Bathsheba, he is still a man who is pursuing God's own heart. You have to remember, the heart is where we decide. And Donald Trump has decided to stand on behalf of the poor. He has and his policies show that. He has decided to stand on side of the unborn, and his policies have shown that. So it's about the decisions that makes one a man after God's own heart. It's not about the talk. It's about the decisions and the actions. And so because of the decisions and actions of Donald Trump, I'm voting for him, and I encourage other Christians to do the same.
Okay, very well. So let's move on to U.S.-China relations.